All right, it's talk time now. The Appropriation Committee has formally reacted to the ongoing face-off between its former chairman and the Speaker of the House of Representatives.
The committee has disowned the erstwhile chairman, Abdul Mumin Jibrin, describing his revelations as cheap blackmail. National Assembly correspondent Joke Adisa reports.
After days of silence, the Appropriation Committee says the erstwhile chairman acted in error by divulging what was supposed to be an internal affair of the House. Jibril's second-in-command said on behalf of the committee that the ousted chairman allegedly eloped with the budget for 3 weeks. Chris Azubuogu said Jibril failed to carry members along in the budget process.
Every zone gets 10 billion, and that's where everybody gets shares from. Then from other things that happens in the leadership of the National Assembly, not House of Rep. The leadership, do you understand, have their own method, and it's for the leadership to decide. And it's something that concerns the leadership. And even in the presidency or in the judiciary, there are questions that are not answered.
The committee won't also accept there was padding of the budget and insists no breach in the appropriation process that would necessitate the intervention of an external body.
If, for instance, my constituency require a breach and then they propose a hospital, I can say no. What my constituency require is a breach and not a hospital. So the House has a right to via some of the projects to different zones or to different areas. So that does not amount to padding.
Why didn't he raise all these allegations before he was removed? Why is it that he's reacting to his removal with all these baseless and unfounded allegations against his colleagues and the leadership of the National Assembly? The press should know this, that the man is drowning and he wants to carry a lot of people along with him.
The Appropriation Committee says the word pardon is alien to parliamentary parlance and views the scenario playing out as diversionary and indicative of external interference. Choke Adisa, TVC News, Abuja.
Right in the studio to look at the budget padding scandal is a lawyer, Tunji Adeyemi. It's good to have you on TVC Breakfast.
Yeah, thank you.
For joining us.
Thank you very much.
And of course, joining us from Abuja is the Executive Director of Friends in the Gap Legislative Advocacy, Mr. George Oji. Good morning to you and thanks for joining us.
It's my pleasure to be here.
All right, let's start it this way. Tunji, let me come to you. You've been following these events all the while. What really goes through your mind when you hear some of these scandals from the National Assembly, from government, running money is running into billions of money generally?
Well, let me start by saying one, there is no scandal anyway.
Okay.
It is just that we are beginning to understand the legislative process of budgeting, which is strange to us because we have not gone through these technicalities before. Number one, as long as whatever was inserted into the budget or allegedly inserted into the budget was presented before the House at the plenary and it was approved, nothing criminal has been done.
Okay, let's bring in George Oji and see if he agrees with you.
Number one, as long as whatever was inserted into the budget or allegedly inserted into the budget was presented before the House at the plenary and it was approved, nothing criminal has been done.
Okay, let's bring in George Oji and see if he agrees with you. George, I guess in the studio, Tunji Adeyemo believes that offense really has been committed by these members. Do you agree with him?
Permit me the privilege to disagree with him on this matter. The position of my group, Friends in the Gap Advocacy Initiative, is that there's been a serious breach. Why did I say this? Although it's not expressly stated in the Constitution that the National Assembly should do what they are doing, but by Section 80 of the Constitution of the country, the lawmakers have powers of appropriation. And what are we talking about here? What that means is that they have all the rights to look at the appropriation estimate brought to the National Assembly by the president. And in doing that, they have every right to, you know, adjust all the contents of that document. What is important is that they are not exceeding the amount presented to the presented to them by the president. Why we are having this issue now is that in carrying out that responsibility, there is no transparency, there is no inclusiveness. If you agree that what you are doing is the right thing, then you should, you know, be open and let it be participatory. If everybody had been aware of the adjustment that had taken place, we would have been talking what we are talking now, okay? And by the way, the reaction of the House Committee on Communication that there was no pardon, it didn't surprise some of us. If you recall what happened in the Senate recently on the matter regarding forgery, this was exactly the same scenario that played out. But we all know that somebody like Senator Kabiru Marafa was thoroughly frustrated when he raised the issue, when he asked the Senate to investigate the alleged forgery. In fact, there was a conspiracy among the majority of the senators that there was no forgery. But we all knew there was forgery. It was based on that frustration that he was compelled to approach the Inspector General of Police to, you know, complain about the alleged forgery. The same scenario is playing out right now in the House. The leadership of the House has come out to say there was no budget pardon. But the characters directly involved, particularly the chairman of the Appropriation Committee, is insisting there was a budget pardon that took place. What we had expected was for them to have offered him the opportunity to prove his case and not to you know, shout him down by saying that nothing of such took place. Exactly the same thing that happened in the Senate.
Right, so, gentlemen, just hold on. George Oji and Tunji Adeyemi, of course, right here in the studio. Let's give our viewers deeper insights into this. The controversy trailing the 2016 budget is perhaps the biggest integrity test on the National Assembly since the document was presented last December.
Now, it began early in the year with the shocking claim by the Senate that the document was missing. At that time, there were indications that the document was secretly withdrawn by the president in order to make some adjustments following the falling prices of oil in the international market.
Now, the objective, it was claimed, was to adjust the benchmark of $38 per barrel proposed for the 2016 fiscal year, since the crude oil price was $30.5 per barrel. But the presidency later denied withdrawing the budget.
Now, the Senate thereafter claimed it discovered 10 billion naira questionably smuggled into the budget of the Ministry of Education for an allegedly questionable subhead. Now, the Minister of Health, Isaac Adewale, then disowned the allocation submitted on its behalf by the Ministry of Budget and National Planning, claiming the proposal had been doctored.
After the passage of the budget in March, the president declined to give his assent. He accused the lawmakers of adding new projects to the document. The presidency also claimed that critical items proposed were removed. For example, the Lagos-Calabar rail project comes to mind.
Now, on May the 6th, the president finally signed the budget, ending weeks of disagreement with the National Assembly. Now, that's the background. Now, let me come to you, Tunji Adeyemi here. You said there is no scandal anywhere. Now, let us take it back to the defense of the appropriation generally. Ministers were called at several times to defend the budget of their ministries, and we heard from them sometimes. Several of them complained that this is not the amount I submitted to the that was part of what was submitted to the National Assembly. These figures don't tally. From that point, wasn't there a problem?
Let's look at it this way. Mm. For instance, the executive can say, okay, we are going to spend 10 billion. The legislature can say, look, we want to increase it to 20 billion. It is normal. There is no legal violation anywhere. You see, we need to understand that the process of budgeting is complicated and it is very technical. Perhaps in the past, we have not taken this very serious. So that is why we are having these issues. I think what we should be looking at now is how to strengthen this process in the National Assembly. For instance, we are talking about a bridge. There was a provision for rail line from Lagos to Calabar. It was moved to Kano. Yes, it can be done. For instance, they will look at it and say, okay, fine, what is the economic impact of a rail line from Lagos to Calabar compared with a rail line from Lagos to Kano? You have more agricultural produce moving from Kano to Lagos than what you have from Calabar to Lagos. So on that basis, they can say, fine, we are moving it to Kano. You understand? Yeah. I think what was lacking was there was no, we did not have enough consultation between the executive and the legislature in the process of this budgeting. Usually, by now, they should have been consulting towards 2017 budget. That is how it is done in other countries. You look, okay, this is what we want to do. Ministry of Health says, okay, I want to site a national emergency center in Abuja. Somebody says, okay, fine, you can do that, but for me to allow you to do that, you need to also make it true and cite the other one in my village. It is normal. It is called lobbying. You understand? It is called lobbying. Yes, these things are not stated in the law, but like Mr. Oji said, the National Assembly has the power to approve appropriation. And in doing that, they can resort to subtle blackmail, which is allowed. If you want me to approve this for you, you must do this for me. I think why we are having this problem is because in the process, like you have heard from the commentary we had before now, in the process, some members of the House hijacked the process and others were not carried along. That was what happened. But as long as it was tabled before the whole House and it was approved, yes, there might have been some violation of ethics, of moral code, but nothing criminal has been done.
Okay, so both gentlemen are on the same page, yourself and of course Mr. Oji there in Abuja, that the legislature, the House, as it were, in this case, does have the right to change figures, whether to increase, to reduce, or allow it to actually remain the same. But the problem here seems to be the arbitrariness, according to, Jibrin, you know, of in the process. Let me come to you, George. Paint a picture for us so that we can understand this. What exactly is the process, you know, when it comes to adjusting figures downwards, upwards, or allowing the figures to remain the same, you know, with the appropriation bill? What exactly is the process? I mean, you've said that the National Assembly really does have the right to do that.
Okay. Let me thank my colleague at your end, because he has connected back to me now. The procedure adopted by the lawmaker that gave rise to the situation we are was quite wrong. Just to, you know, have a quick recap, when Mr. President lays the document on the table before the joint parliament, it is considered to have undergone the first reading. The lawmakers will schedule a day in their order paper where the appropriation document will be debated, the principles of it, you know, we begin to discuss whether this is a budget of hope, how it is predicated on a certain benchmark, how it's going to help achieve alleviation of poverty and stuff and stuff. It's called a debate on the principles of the document. Then we move to the third stage, which where the document is returned to the various committees. The committee on education, the committee on health, and all of that, they all take their own components of the budget. And then we begin what they call budget defense. And that is when you invite the ministers, the heads of department to come and provide explanations on some of the items contained in their own proposal. Let me make the point at this stage that at this stage, The lawmakers and the MDS are supposed to agree among themselves and come to a conclusion on what should be contained in the document. It is never done within a closed door. Whatever agreement you're going to reach must be, agreed between the two parties. That is why if you're going to change any party, any item in the document, you have to explain why. And it is superior argument that will, override at the end of the day. And that is why by the time at the committee level, the document has been agreed upon, the minister can go home, realize that he knows every item that is contained in his ministry. And if Mr. President summons him, he should be able to answer and provide explanation to all the documents there. That was why we had problem the other time when Mr. President wanted to sign the document, he stopped. Because he invited some of his ministers to come and explain the new changes and additions and subtractions. They couldn't. What did that tell us? It told us that when the ministers had left, the lawmakers went and altered the figures. Okay? Like I said, what is causing this controversy now is because the process is not inclusive and it is not transparent. If everybody had been aware of what happened, it wouldn't have been any issue. The allegations the chairman of the Appropriation Committee is raising now. It is only an issue because when the rest of the lawmakers had gone home, a few people called themselves into a room and begin to allocate figures. That is what is giving rise to what we are seeing right now. It's not inclusive and it is not transparent. That is the point. And I thank my colleague, the lawyer, the other side, for agreeing with me on this point.
Okay, now, Abdul Mumini claims that this adjustment, or padding, as it were, was done after the House had approved the document.
Okay.
Does the House have the right to do that after the document had been approved, or should it be before?
Approved at what level? Is it at plenary or at committee stage?
Okay, well, good question.
If it was changed after it had been approved at plenary, then that becomes forgery. And that takes us back to the kind of situation we have now in the Senate. Mm. But if it was adjusted after the committee had approved it, yes, it's a violation of the ethics of the House, but it is not criminal. What that now means is that we need to now go back and look at the rules of passing budget in both houses of the National Assembly. Like I said, why we are having this is because, you see, in the past, the government, they don't respect the budget. Pass whatever you want to pass, we will do what we want to do. But now we are having a president that says, look, I want to follow this document letter by letter. So let me know what I have to work with.
All right.
Okay.
Tunji, we'll come back to this shortly so we have a better understanding. We're going on another short commercial break and then we come back on the program. Stay with us. You're watching TVC Breakfast and we are talking about the budget padding scandal in the House, even though we have a lawyer in the House, Tunji Adeyemi, who said there is no scandal involved in that at all. But certainly we are digging deep into the issues to have a better understanding of what it is, what went wrong that's leading to the ripples in the National Assembly, and what should Nigerians understand about this. We also have George Oji with us in our Abuja studio, and we are talking about it. Now let's break things down further for you to understand. On May the 6th, President Muhammadu Buhari signed a budget of 6.06 trillion into law. 2.2 trillion deficit, that's the amount of money the federal government will borrow, and then 1.59 trillion naira on capital expenditure, that is the amount that will be spent on projects like road construction, building hospitals and schools, and lots more.
2.65 trillion naira recurrent expenditure, 1.48 trillion for debt servicing, 351.4 billion naira for statutory transfer and 3.86 trillion revenue forecast. Now let's look at some of the grey areas. In March, the National Assembly approved and forwarded a budget of 6.06 trillion to the presidency, thus reducing the president's proposal by 17 billion naira. The 17 billion naira reduction was taken from overhead votes component of the 2.65 trillion naira recurrent expenditure of the budget, which has now been reduced to 2.646 trillion naira.
Now, from the 351.370 billion naira approved for statutory transfers, the National Assembly gets 115 billion naira, the largest sum for independent arms of government. Now, some of the projects allegedly injected into the budget by the Committee on Appropriation to the exclusion of other constituencies include 40 billion naira for projects in the geopolitical zones of the leadership of the Senate and the House. And it had been programmed that principal officers in the two chambers would benefit 20 billion naira projects apiece in their areas from the budget, in line with the tradition kept since 1999.
And Mike, don't forget that this 40 billion naira is what Abdul Mumin Jibrin, former head appropriation committee, is accusing Dogara and three other men. Now he's added another 10, you know, to this allegations right now. He's saying they're appropriating this amount, huge sums, to themselves. Now, let's even look at this. Jibrin has taken his anti-corruption war now to the four anti-corruption agencies, the EFCC and the rest of them.
ICPC.
The ICPC.
The DSS and the police.
Do you believe that Jibrin is a whistleblower, or is he just an accidental hero? Is it a case of sour grapes? And should that affect the whole, you know, thing we're talking about here, about, you know, corruption in the National Assembly, especially in the lower house?
Well, I would say that Honorable Jibrin is just displaying ignorance of the process that he was involved in. Let us say there was an infraction. This ought to have been left to the House to deal with. Like I said, there is nothing criminal. And I know that at the end of the day, we are not likely to have any criminal proceedings being instituted. Yes, the way the leadership of the National Assembly inserted this might not have been in line with the procedure of the House, but then it's for them to deal with. See, budgeting, let me ask you this question. How do you ensure equal and even development of every part of the country if senators, House of Rep members, don't have the right to insert projects into the budget? Don't forget, these are politicians. They have to show something to their constituencies that, look, this is what I achieved while I was there. And the executive, because they may not be representative of the whole country, they are likely to say, okay, I want to do this, Abuja, let's develop Abuja, let's develop Lagos. But a member from Bauchi knows what his people need. So he can come and say, fine, develop Abuja, develop Lagos, but give me this so that I can also take it to my people. That is how countries are developed. Go to the US, that's how it is done. You understand? Even sometimes, before you even come to the House officially, there will have been some discussions at the background, knowing that if I don't concede this, I will not get this.
Oh, okay. Before we go to Oji in Abuja, I would like to understand this. Now, when a budget is produced, it is expected that it is to the best of the interests of the entire country.
Yes.
Whether you live in Lagos, or you live in Kazaure, or you live in Oju, in Benue State, or wherever you live, it is expected that if this budget of, let's say, the 6.6 trillion naira, if it goes into implementation, Nigerians should feel the impact of this, irrespective of where you are. Okay. Now, lawmakers, on the other hand, constitutionally, have been earmarked to say, okay, fine, we monitor what the executive arm of government is doing to ensure that this budget we have signed for you, you implement it to the latter for Nigerians, the same constituent or citizens of these representatives from maybe the village of Adoka or the village of Kazauri, for instance, to feel the impact. Now, if that is the case, the ideal constitutional responsibility of these arms of government, wouldn't that be a duplication of projects to say, okay, House of lawmakers now have constituency funds to show back to their own people as to this is what I am trying to attract to my people back in the villages, as the case may be, when there is already a provision for the a budget to handle all of these things? Wouldn't that amount to duplication?
Well, you see, one, you are assuming that whatever the executive brings, they will have taken into consideration the whole country. But in practice, it is not always so. Let me give you an example. Look at the appointments the president has made so far. It has tilted to one side. He has his reasons. We will not blame him for that. But that is why you now have the National Assembly. Don't forget, you see, the philosophy behind having two chambers is to make sure that every part of the country is represented. One, you have the House of Reps that is based on population. You have the Senate that gives each state equal representation. The idea is to balance. So when it comes to them, they look at it and say, okay, fine, you have brought this, but we believe that we need to get this. We need to get this. Ordinarily, this should have been ironed out by just discussions. Okay, I will concede this, I will give you this. And at the end of the day, it is the result of these discussions that should be presented to the two chambers for approval.
Okay, so let me bring George Oji in quickly before we go in further to give some statistics and data or deeper information to this. Now, let me throw the same question at you, George. In a situation where you have this going on right now, don't you think the foundation was already laid where the appropriation bill itself seems not to have taken into cognizance the interest of, you know, the every part of the country, so that you don't have a situation where lawmakers have to tamper with the figures that have been laid out, you know, by the president? Is there a need to go back to that? I mean, going forward, this might provide some kind of lesson for everyone involved.
Oh, yes, on this matter, I connect again with Tunji. Don't forget that these are ministers. They were appointed by Mr. President. They do Mr. President bidding largely. But we have elected representatives who come from various parts of this country, and they must go home one day to give account of their representation at the center. It's incumbent on them to ensure that they draw part of national development to their constituencies. If we are not suffering from short of memory, that was the origin of the constituency projects during Obasanjo's era. They made the argument that, look, and by the way, there's nothing wrong with it, if I may just interject at this point. So long that these projects are not executed in Niger or Somalia or Sierra Leone, what it goes to ensure is even development. I mean, that is good. But there's a point Tunji touched on, but he didn't dwell so much on it. And that is the point where we talk about lobbying. I don't think we have developed enough culture of lobbying in this country. The projects that are at issue in the House now between the Appropriation Committee Chairman and the Speaker, so to speak, I didn't expect Mr. Speaker to wait at this stage to ensure that he draws some projects to his constituency. What stopped him at the level when they were, you know, putting the budget together, to call the Minister of Budget Planning and tell him that, look, you know where I came from, I need to show cause what I'm doing for my people in Abuja. You lobby him to put some special project for your constituency. So if the project had come from the president or the executive ab initio, I think his colleagues in the National Assembly will respect him as their speaker. But his status as a speaker will influence those projects to go through. Why would you want to wait at this stage to get involved in what I call, you know, illegality? It is wrong. We have to develop this culture of lobby. That is what democracy and presidential democracy is all about.
All right then. The current controversy is not the first in Nigeria's democracy. The legislature and executive have engaged in different battles over padding of budget since Nigeria returned to democratic rule 17 years ago. And so we start with former President Olusegun Obasanjo's budget of 2000.
Now, President Obasanjo refused to sign the budget passed by the National Assembly in 2000, claiming it had been padded with about 2 billion naira. The lawmakers had allegedly added extra 2 billion naira to the 22 billion naira allocated to the National Assembly. Now, Obasanjo also identified 15 other areas which he said were contentious in the document passed by the lawmakers.
However, after weeks of face-off between the two arms of government, the former president agreed to sign the budget on the condition that he would bring a supplementary bill to address the contentious issues. In 2005, the then Senate President Adolphus Wabara, alongside some senators and members of the House of Reps, were fingered in the alleged offer of bribe by the Ministry of Education to pad the ministry's budget. The senators involved in the bribe for budget scandal were Ibrahim Aziz, John Mbata, Badamasi Machido, Chris Adigije, Emmanuel Okwede, Shehu Matazu, and Gabriel Suswam, who later became Benue State Governor.
Now, President Obasanjo, in a nationwide broadcast, said that the then Education Minister, Fabian Osuji, and others from the executive arm bribed the lawmakers with the 55 million naira to increase budgetary allocation to the ministry. Now, on March 22nd, the former president dismissed Mr. Osuji from the cabinet, while Wabara subsequently resigned from his position after much pressure. Let's look at other cases in that light. Now, late President Umaru Musa Yar'Adua in 2008 prepared a total national budget of 3 trillion naira. But while working on the budget, the legislators raised the allocation for some items.
For instance, the harmonization committee set up by the two chambers raised the figures to 34 billion naira for the Senate and 59 billion naira for the House. The figures for the meal and refreshment were also increased. The outrageous increase resulted in the president refusing to sign the budget. And of course, President Goodluck Jonathan's 2011 budget was perhaps most outrageous of the conflicts on budgets. The padding of that year's budget was largely to enhance the lawmakers' salaries and allowances.
And that year, the National Assembly increased its budget from about 120 billion naira to 123 billion naira, or 132 billion naira rather, while working on the 4.48 billion naira budget presented by the former president.
Jonathan refused to sign the budget, prompting series of meetings for negotiations. In the end, both parties settled for 150 billion naira as allocation to the lawmakers.
120 billion naira to 123 billion naira, or 132 billion naira rather, while working on the 4.48 billion naira budget presented by the former president.
Jonathan refused to sign the budget, prompting series of meetings for negotiations. In the end, both parties settled for 150 billion naira as allocation to the lawmakers. Now, that allocation only dropped marginally to 115 billion in 2015. And in the nation's budget of 4.42 trillion naira, due to public complaints that the legislature was becoming too expensive to maintain. Now, strangely also, from that year, the National Assembly stopped providing details of its allocations in the budgets. It's quite interesting, you know, like, so yes, let's go to George now. Look, we're not just talking about budget padding here in this case. You know, Abdulmumin Jibrin has raised quite a number of issues. He actually says that there are widespread institutional corruption in the House, from issues of bribery from multinationals, of the Speaker Dogara, and, you know, so many things. Should we take this really, really seriously? It is obvious we've been here before as far as the issue of padding is concerned. But should we take this even more seriously than we have done in the past?
You see, I'm a little worried about the actions of Muminu, the former appropriation chairman. I'm worried why it is at this stage that he's raising all of this alarm. What I had expected him to do, if he's a man of integrity, as he tried to portray, was that immediately at that point, he thought that the leadership of this house was trying to influence him to violate the rules. That was when he would have raised the alarm. I didn't know why he waited at this point. Is he saying that if they had not removed him as chairman of the appropriation committee, all of these details wouldn't have been coming out? That is where I have issues. Okay. But having said that, I think there is an important issue to raise at this point, and that is the issue of fair hearing to members of both chambers of the parliament. Like I did mention before, what is happening is that the former appropriation committee chairman doesn't seem to have confidence in the machineries of the house to give him voice to express himself. I think it's important. What is happening now had happened in the Senate, as I said earlier. Somebody like Senator Kabiru Marafa was thoroughly frustrated when he raised the critical issue about the alleged forgery of the Senate standing rule. I recall that he made four unsuccessful attempts to get this Senate president to investigate the matter, but he was frustrated. And it was out of that frustration that he had to take recourse to petitioning the Inspector General of Police to begin to probe into a matter that ought to have been resolved internally.
Okay.
The same thing is equally happening now in the House.
All right.
I'm worried about this.
All right, George Orji, Executive Director of Friends in the Gap Legislative Advocacy, thank you for talking to us on TVC Breakfast. Thank you. And we still have Tunji Adeyemi in the House. Now, let us get into understanding the constituency funds. This has been this has been on since 1999. Has there really been justification for the allocation for constituency projects?
Clearly, there is none. And it ought not to have been. It's just because you see, it's our own shortcut route of handling things in Nigeria. What we should have and what we should all advocate for is for the National Assembly to have a rule. Maybe they need to go abroad and study other legislatures to see how they do it. For instance, I will expect a situation where they will have a rule that says, okay, every ranking senator from a state will be able to insert a capital project into the budget, provided no other lawmaker from that state will object.
Okay, we'll have to leave it there, Tunji Adeyemi, lawyer. And of course, we had George Orji, who joined us, Friends in the Gap Advocacy Group. Thank you so much for your time and your insight on TVC Breakfast.